G'day, it's Rowan from Ferguson Brothers Rail. This video, I'm going to show you how I used a rotary switch. That's this little guy here. Instead of a toggle switch, to control these single slips. So we can have locos passing from one parallel piece of parallel track to another and vice versa. The rotary switch, it did take me a little bit of time to figure this out. You can see it's all wired up here. Didn't want to waste video time going through all that process, but I will take a step backwards and explain how this circuit works. To begin with, let me introduce the rotary switch. This is a four pole, three position rotary switch. Each pole acts like its own switch. As you turn the knob, internal contacts rotate across a fixed set of terminals. And this little part, it's a stop washer. It limits how far the switch can turn. I've set it to three clicks because my four motors can be grouped into three combinations. Think of a rotary switch like a pizza. There are 12 flavors you could possibly make, but today we only need four. The stop washer steps in and says, "All right, chef, just four on the menu today." I'm using it to control four turnouts across two parallel tracks. Center, both tracks go straight. Turn left, track A crosses to track B. Turn right, track B crosses to track A. So with one simple control, I can manage four motors. Now let's take a closer look at how it's wired. The MTB MP1 turnout motors I'm using have six terminals, but think of it as two separate switches that both fire at the same time. Terminals 1, 2, and 3 are for the switch motor itself. Terminals 4, 5, and 6 are for the second switch. You could use this second switch for whatever you want. Most people use it to control frog polarity, as I do. Let's talk about the turnout switch. Common goes in the center, which is actually terminal 2. Then depending which side the circuit is closed, determines which direction the motor moves. So the logic to control that comes from the rotary switch. The travel distance or throw distance can be configured for 3, 6 or 9 millimeters. So I've got mine set on the smallest for end scale. I mark an end on the body to remind me which motors I've prepared for the layout. The other three terminals are part of an internal switch. They're completely separate from the first three. The trickiest part was avoiding circuit leakage, especially since I'm also using the rotary switch to control green LEDs showing which route is active. I started by breaking down the three combinations I needed. From there, I drew a matrix and then made three diagrams showing the current flow in each position. The key was ensuring two things. Only the correct pair of motors receive power per switch position, but also that the idle motors still get their correct polarity even when they're not moving. Let's look at a diagram. This isn't a formal circuit diagram, it's a pictorial layout to help visualize where the wires physically need to go. Here's the center position. Both tracks are straight, so locos can pass freely. Red lines indicate positive voltage for my 12 volt DC supply, but here's the thing. I'm using the negative side of the circuit for switching logic. That means the common terminals on the rotary switch are connected to ground, not positive. This is known as negative side switching. The center terminals of the rotary switch are all grouped together. It's basically four switches sharing a single ground input. In this default position, number 1 and number 4 are doing the work. They complete the circuit to the first terminal of each motor. These outputs work in pairs, so number 1 drives two motors and so does number 4. Terminals 9, 10 and 11 are purely for the green LEDs. The 5mm LEDs I'm using have resistors built in, which makes that part easy. Now let's flip the switch to the top position. Now number 5 and number 8 are active. Motors 3 and 4 don't need to change this time. Number 2 isn't doing anything here, and that's fine. Not every terminal gets a job. Switching down to the bottom position through the center. Now number 3 and number 12 carry the current, powering the opposite pair of motors. Each switch position needs to be clean, no current leaks and no crossed logic. Here's what it looks like in real life. Looks like spaghetti, right? But every color follows a pattern. The wiring from the circuit board matches the colors in the diagram, which really helps when you're debugging. For the motors, positive or red connects to the common terminal. Switching logic uses the negative side, so I've used white and yellow wires instead of black, otherwise there'd be too many black wires. Also, only use white or yellow to indicate DC circuits.
which helps trace things visually when you've got AC and DC in close proximity. For the LEDs, red wires carry positive voltage to each LED anode via a built-in resistor. The black wires coming from the rotary switch decide which LED completes the circuit to ground. The white plastic terminal block top left handles DC power to turnout motors. This just means I can remove the module if I need to without cutting wires. A separate larger terminal block handles AC track power, with red for positive and black for neutral. You'll see all the extra red and black drop feeds placed before and after each frog. Blue wires are input from the track, either neutral or positive, and the green wires are output to the frog based on the switch position. I've got a separate video explaining how I modify turnouts for smoother operation that might explain why there are so many drop feeds. Now you can come up with something that works better for you. It's just a case of keeping a multimeter within arm's reach at all times and test, test, test. I'll be building another version of this controller and I guarantee it'll be neater. You always improve with each iteration. Onto the panel design. I sketched the control panel by hand, transferred it to Illustrator, and then a friend laser-etched it for me with his printer. This version doesn't have its side enclosures yet. I'll show you that in the next video. The final panel will be angled for easier viewing on the layout fascia. For now, it's sitting loose while I finish the surrounding scenery. I'm aiming for a consistent style across all the control panels. The green LEDs are a little bright and they could do with some more resistance, but I'll see how it goes during operation first. Convenience is a top priority for me. Designing this controller as a standalone module made everything easier. It's secured with four screws and I've used terminal blocks to hook it up to both the AC and DC power buses. This whole unit sits on the swinging gate section of the layout. In the next video, I'll show you how I build scenery around this and factor in some adjustability to ensure the tracks line up. Thanks for watching, and please reach out if you'd like a copy of the wiring diagram.